Dear believers, thank you for joining us for the virtual Sunday service. I, on behalf of Daily Lota Christian Fellowship, extend warm greetings and welcome you all to this virtual service in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Today we are blessed to have an esteemed speaker, Pastor Chandra, who will be sharing the wonderful Word of God, and we look forward to a wonderful and blessed time of worship. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we give you thanks and praise you for your greatness, your love, and your mercy. O Father, though we always stumble and fall, your mercy and grace always finds us. Father, as we continue this virtual service, we ask that your Holy Spirit would be at work. Fill us with your love and open our ears and our hearts to receive your word. And may we be transformed into your likeness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Today's scripture is taken up from Acts chapter 4, verses 23 to 31. Acts chapter 4, verses 23 to 31, and the topic is the believer's prayer. On the release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up and the rulers band together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate meet together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. This is the word of God. May God bless us all. Amen.
Good afternoon, DLCF. It's great to be able to share God's word with you after a long, long time. I hope you've been keeping well. It's been, you know, almost a year now, really, if you think about it, since we've been in this kind of a situation since March, about March this year. And hopefully you're well as a church, your families are keeping well, and that you continue to have fellowship, even if it's online, that you're able to somehow connect with each other, even through the week, maybe through phone calls or messages or those sorts of things. We need community, right? We need community so much more at a time like this. But thank you for the privilege of being able to share God's word with you at this time in your worship service. I bring greetings from Delhi Bible Fellowship, Dwarka. Our church is also doing well. We've also been meeting online through Zoom, like most other churches at this time. And we're trying to compensate for that by, you know, having life groups online and things like that, and fellowship. But thank you for having me here this morning. I want to invite you to join with me as we look into God's Word at this time. Now, this afternoon, I would like to speak to you about how we as believers have God's ear. That was the title for this message. I don't know if you saw that, but how we have God's ear. And what I mean by that is how God, the Almighty God, is inclined to listening to us. He's inclined to hearing us when we pray. Isn't that magnificent when you think about it? The God who created the universe is interested in what you have to say to him in prayer. That's just staggering when you think about it. But prayer is also a means of grace in our life. It's a means where God pours out his grace into our lives when we pray, and we enjoy and experience his presence and his leading and his wisdom and his guidance and his strength when we pray. And it's a means of God's grace. You know, David Matthes, who's written a book called The Habits of Grace. Great book, by the way. And I'll try and send you the link so you can download it. It's a free download that you can get. And he's written a book, The Habits of Grace. And he says this about prayer. He says, prayer, simply put, is talking to God. It is irreducibly relational. I like that. It's irreducibly relational. It's personal in that he is the absolute person and we are the derivative persons fashioned in his image. So in a sense, prayer is as basic as persons relating to each other. You got that? It's as basic as persons relating to each other, conversing, interacting, but with a significant caveat. In this relationship, we don't chat as peers. He is creator and we are creatures. He is the great Lord and we are his happy servants. Yet, listen to this, because of his amazing love and extravagant grace, he invites us to interact. He invites us to interact. That's amazing to me. And so I want us to think about prayer at this time of worship, at this time of the word here together this afternoon. Now, what is the great purpose of prayer? What is the great purpose of prayer? Since prayer, like I said before just now in that quote, that since prayer is relational, it should not surprise us that the purpose of prayer is not finally about getting things from God, but about getting God himself. Prayer is not finally about getting things from God, but about getting God himself. Listen to what C.S. Lewis says about prayer. He says, prayer, in the sense of petition, asking for things, is a small part of it. Confession and penitence are its threshold, adoration its sanctuary, the presence and vision and enjoyment of God its bread and wine. Beautiful, isn't it? The presence and vision and enjoyment of God is really, really what we want. The bread and the wine is what we have in prayer when we fellowship with God. Now, it's important for us to grasp this, really important for us to grasp, because we usually think of prayer in terms of asking things from God, right? We want his blessing for our meals. We want his protection when we go out. We want his favor at our places of work. We want his providence for our families. We want his generosity for our requests and our desires. We want his healing for our hurts, and we want his forgiveness for our sins. And so we want all his gifts, but do we want the giver of the gifts? Do we want the giver of the gifts? Imagine, think about this for a moment. You know, if there was someone who constantly asked you for things, like they wanted to borrow your stuff, like they wanted to borrow your phone, you know what, just 2 minutes, I just need to make a call, and they're always borrowing your phone. Or maybe they want to borrow some money from you. Or maybe they want to borrow your car or your scooter. You know, I just need to make a trip down to the market. I want to do this, I want to do that. And they're constantly borrowing stuff from you, so on and so forth. But they never really seem to care about you. They never really seem to spend time with you. And all they seem to want is your things, but not really you. How would you feel about that? How would you feel? And you know what? It's interesting because we do the very same thing with God. Our prayers reveal that God is nothing more than a means to an end, like a glorified shopkeeper even, right? Because he's a means to an end. We only go to him for things. But the real purpose of prayer is God and fellowship with God. And it's deeply dishonoring and disrespectful, I think, to only go to God for our needs and not to go to him for him. Think about how Jesus practiced prayer in his life. Why do you think Jesus prayed? You know, he prayed primarily because he enjoyed fellowship with his Father. I mean, there's several instances of it in the Gospels where Jesus withdraws to spend time in prayer. There's that one occasion when he feeds the thousands, and it's a powerful miracle, like these 12 baskets overflowing at the end of that meal. And at the end of the food distribution, which must have been quite a task and quite tiring even, and it seems like the disciples were exhausted, Jesus sends the disciples away on a boat, And then he disperses the crowd himself, and we read about this in Matthew chapter 14. And then after all of that, it says, after he had dismissed the crowd, verse 23, he went up to the mountain to by himself to pray. And when evening came, he was there alone. After a long, heavy day, Jesus went to pray. Amazing, isn't it? And then in Mark 1:35, we read that Jesus, rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, departed and went to a desolate place. And there he prayed. And it's like, you know, Jesus loved the presence of his Father. He loved that fellowship. And it was that time that gave him great strength even to face the day and to do the work that he had before him. But that time was really, really important to Jesus. He didn't find other things to entertain himself. He went to the presence of God. I love it. And I think Jesus prayed, and I know that Jesus prayed because he enjoyed fellowship with the Father. He enjoyed fellowship with the Father. You know, it's amazing when I think about this. It's amazing how you and I, we carry on without prayer in our lives, as if we can somehow manage things, as if we can manage, you know, unlike Jesus in that sense, like he needed to pray. We can manage somehow. Is it any wonder that so many of us are weak and sick and tired and discouraged and frustrated, often anxious, struggling with sin, angry? Is it any wonder that we are like that? Because we don't pray. We don't spend time with God. If you and I would only spend time with God, the character of Christ would rub off on us. The character of Christ would rub off on us. Imagine our responses to life being the way Christ responded to life, the way he handled situations and circumstances and opposition and persecution and difficulties and trials. Imagine if how he was able to handle all of that. If we could spend time with Jesus, we would handle it in the same way. And I'm not just saying this off the top of my head. In Acts chapter 4, when Peter and John, I believe, were arrested, and they were brought before the religious authorities, and they were questioned and challenged, and they were told not to speak in the name of Jesus. One of the observations that their accusers saw of them, made of them, their religious leaders made of them, is in Acts chapter 4, verse 13. Let me read that to you. It says over here, "Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, they perceived that they were uneducated, common men, and they were astonished. And they recognized that they had been with Jesus." Wow, look at that. They recognized that Peter and John had been with Jesus. They were ordinary, unschooled men. But what set them apart is that they had been with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I ask you, can people tell that you have been with Jesus in fellowship, in prayer? Can they tell that from your life? Can they see that in your life? So I ask you at this time, how is your private prayer life? How is your private prayer life? Or as Jesus says, you know, praying in secret in Matthew chapter 6, verse 6. Are you praying in secret? Are you spending time with God in secret? I like what Tim Keller says about closet prayer. That's what he calls it. And he comments on Matthew 6, verse 6, and he says this: "The infallible test of spiritual integrity, Jesus says, is your private prayer life." Let me say that again. The infallible test of spiritual integrity, Jesus says, is your private prayer life. Many people will pray when they are required by cultural or social expectation, or perhaps by the anxiety caused by a troubling circumstance. Those with a genuinely lived relationship with God as Father, however, will inwardly want to pray, and therefore will pray even though nothing on the outside is pressing them to do so. They pursue it even during times of spiritual dryness, when there is no social or experiential payoff. Those who genuinely live in a relationship with the Father will pray, doesn't matter what's going on around them, good or bad, they will enjoy being with the Father. And I like that beginning bit, right? The infallible test of spiritual integrity is your private prayer life. It's easy to pray in public when everybody expects you and it looks good and you stand in front of a pulpit and you pray for different things, but you pray in private. That's a test of spiritual integrity. But not only is prayer a test of spiritual integrity, it's also a remedy for inadequacy. It's a remedy for inadequacy. You see, praying will help you get over not praying. Praying will help you get over not praying. Praying will help you desire God when you don't desire Him. Prayer will help you conquer spiritual dryness in your life. It is a remedy for our hearts when our hearts feel hard toward God. Prayer is a remedy for that. It's a remedy for inadequacy. Not only is it a test for your spiritual integrity, it is a remedy for spiritual inadequacy. When you feel dry, pray, pray, pray. It's going to rejuvenate you. It's going to revive you as you spend time with God. It's amazing what it does. Let me give you a few points from Mathis' book. I quoted earlier, you know, David Mathis has written this book. A few points about practicing private prayer, right? And this is hopefully instructional for you as you think about your own private prayer life. Number one, create a space to pray. Have a dedicated space and time that you use for prayer. A dedicated space and time that you use for prayer. And it could be the mornings, which I really think is the best time to pray. But whatever it is, set aside that time, set aside a quiet place in your house and pray. If you don't have a space in your house, go outside to the park and find a quiet spot and sit and pray. Because if you don't set aside the time or the place, prayer is not going to happen. It's not going to happen. Number two, begin with the Bible. You know, when you're praying, read a passage of scripture and let what you read in that scripture direct your thoughts in prayer. Sometimes we wonder what to pray for. Well, pray scripture over people. As you think about people, as you think about your own life, pray scripture over yourself. Let the scriptures direct your prayer life. Another thing to do is to have a pattern of prayer. You can use the acts. A lot of people use adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication as the acts model of prayer. It doesn't matter. You can have any model of prayer that you want, but have a model of prayer so you can begin with adoration, go to confession, have thanksgiving, and then finally supplication, which is asking God for your needs. But have a plan to pray. Fourthly, divulge your desires and develop them. Prayer is a great way to speak your heart to God. It's a great way to go into God's presence and to just pour out your heart to Him. And I've said this before, and it's been challenging to me as well. Instead of grumbling about people and grumbling about your circumstances to other people, first go to God. First go to God. And God is going to help you deal with it in such an amazing way that when you meet other people, you won't have to grumble about it anymore, because the peace of God will fill your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Number five, keep it fresh. You know, sometimes you might be sitting on your couch and praying, and that's fine, but you can change it around. At other times, you can kneel in your room and pray. At other times, you can take a walk and pray, or go to a different place and pray, or use your journal, write a notebook and journal your prayers. It's a great way to practice prayer. Or maybe fast and pray. Occasionally, fast and pray. Withhold food, keep it from you, and spend a whole day in fasting. And what it will do is, as you're going through that day, when you think about food, remember that you're praying and you should be praying. And it's a great way to focus your prayer in a laser sharp kind of way. Focus your prayer. And so those are a few things that you can do as you practice private prayer. But remember, private prayer is a test of your spiritual integrity, because it says that you really are interested in God's presence, but it's also a remedy for your spiritual inadequacy. It's going to help you get over that dryness that you might feel in your life when you pray. But there's another aspect of prayer that I want to talk about, and that has to do with community prayer and the importance of praying together. And I want to direct your attention to Acts chapter 4, verse 23 to 31. And I think that would have been read to you at the start of this service, Acts chapter 4, 23 to 31. And I want you to notice over here that, you know, Peter and John have just been arrested, and they've been told by the religious authorities that they should not proclaim the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, they were beaten and they were sent back. And they came back to the rest of the disciples, and they found the church praying. And they joined together as a church. In fact, they joined together and they began to pray. And I encourage you to go over that passage in detail and look at how beautiful their prayer is. It's such a tremendous focus on the sovereignty of God. They focus on the sovereignty of God so beautifully. What a powerful moment in that church. But then I want you to notice verse 31, Acts chapter 4, verse 31. At the conclusion of that prayer time, listen to the effect of that time of prayer. Let me read this to you. And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness. Amazing, isn't it? It says, where they were gathered was shaken, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness. Something powerful resulted from that prayer time together. There was something powerful in that. And the fruit of that corporate prayer time was that the church was filled with the Spirit, and they went out with boldness to proclaim the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. What do you think of that? I mean, I would love for that to be true of our church where I pastor, or your church, that our churches are filled with the Spirit and with boldness are able to proclaim the word of God. If only we would pray like that. You know, if you ask me honestly, and I said this to our church as well a few weeks ago, I feel a real concern for the church today, and I include myself in that. It seems that there is a lack of zeal for the Lord. A lack of zeal for the Lord. The church today is a lukewarm church, like the church at Laodicea in Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 to 21, where Jesus says, you know, you're neither hot, you're neither cold, but you're lukewarm, and I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. And the church today, I feel, is a lukewarm kind of church. We're only bothered about what we need and what we want. And so all of our spiritual life, all of our prayer life is only geared toward the end of getting things for ourselves, whether it's a particular job, whether it's some money, whether it's some relationship, whether it's something that we want. All we are concerned about is getting things for ourselves. And the church, because of that, is weak today, and it lacks in zeal for the Lord. But if the church could come together and pray like this church in Acts and experience the fullness of the Spirit and the fruit of boldness and confidence to go out and live for Jesus and proclaim the gospel, we could turn the world upside down again. We could do that. You know, there's a church in Brooklyn, New York called the Brooklyn Tabernacle. And I remember reading a book by the pastor. I think it was about 20 years ago that I read this book, but he'd written it some years before that. Jim Cimbala is the name of the pastor. And he talks about this book, it's called Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire, about how the church, when he began pastoring over there, it was a small church, it was a struggling church, there was hardly any money, there were hardly any people that were coming to the services, they were always empty. And so he got his church together, the few, you know, 10, 15 people that were there, and he started praying with them. I think it was on a Tuesday night that they started praying. And that Tuesday night changed that church completely. It became such a powerful time of God's presence and healing and deliverance and restoration and strength that the Tuesday night prayer was more, was filled up more than the Sunday morning service. It outgrew the Sunday morning service. And I think that's still true today. They still have thousands of people that come for the Tuesday night prayer than they even have at their Sunday morning worship service. amazing. And I want, and I desire that the church would be like that again in Delhi, for DLCF, for DBF Dwarka, that we would be a praying church together. And I encourage you to pray as a church together. Now, David Mathis, in his book, The Habits of Grace, he gives us these things that he calls the profits of praying together, or why praying together is profitable. And I want to share some of these with you for your exhortation. All right, just a few of them and we'll close with this. Number one, when we pray together, there is added power. There is added power. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 19, Jesus says, "Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything that you ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven." When two or three of you come together and you pray and you agree on anything, it's done by my Father in heaven. And so there's an added power in our praying together. That's the point that he's making over here. Secondly, we pray together for multiplied joy. For multiplied joy. You know, when it's always hard to get to a prayer meeting. I don't know if you've noticed that. But it's always fulfilling when you leave a prayer meeting. You always feel so happy, so satisfied, so high and excited about the time that you've had in prayer. That's usually the case with me. I think it probably is with you as well, right? It's hard there because our flesh doesn't want to get to the meeting. But once we get there and we pray together, there's just such a unity in prayer. We leave saying, man, we got to do that again. There's multiplied joy in praying together. We want to pray together for greater glory to God. Pray together for greater glory to God. You see, John Piper in a book writes, he writes this, he says, "God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in Him." God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in Him. So if prayer is our enjoyment and satisfaction in God, then God is most glorified when we pray. You got that? So when we pray, we are expressing our glad dependence on God. And when we do that, God is most glorified. And so we give great glory to God when we pray together. Another reason why praying together is good, because it is for fruitful ministry and mission. It multiplies the effectiveness and the fruitfulness of our ministry and our mission. You know, in Ephesians, Paul, in his letter to the Ephesian church, he asked them to pray for him. And he says in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 18 to 20, he says, "Praying at all times with all prayer and supplication." So he's asking them to pray at all times with all prayer and supplication. "To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints and also for me, that words may be given me in the opening of my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak." And so he's asking the church, he's saying, as I proclaim the gospel, pray for me so that the gospel may go out powerfully and effectively. We've got to pray together for the ministries of our church. We've got to pray together for the mission of the gospel around the world. Number five, we pray together for unity among believers. Praying together is, I would say, the single most significant thing that we can do together to cultivate unity in the church. Praying together is the single most significant thing that we can do together to cultivate unity in the church. Praying together is both the effect of the unity we already share in Christ and also the cause for deeper unity in Jesus. So we've got to pray together. Number six, we pray together for answers we otherwise wouldn't receive. We pray together for answers we otherwise wouldn't receive. And I get this from James chapter 5, verse 14 to 16. It says over here, "Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. and if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. And so there are times that we need to be praying together for answered prayer. For some of these things that we've read in James, it's important for the church to be praying together. God means for some answers to prayer to await the joining of others with us. You got that? All right. And then we pray together to learn to grow in our prayers. I mean, the best way to learn prayer is to pray with other people. When you pray with other people, you see their heart, you see the way they pray, you see the words that they use in prayer, you see their commitment to prayer, you see their passion for prayer, you see their dependence on God, and it just helps you in your own prayer life. You know, over this time of lockdown, it's been great because apart from all of the downsides of it, one of the good things has been that, people are able to connect online much more. And so over the last few months, I've gotten together with some of the pastors in the city online. Every Tuesday morning for about 35, 40 minutes, we come together and we have a time of prayer for the city and prayer for lots of different things. And it's really, really been a blessing to me, right? And then I've also been able to join with some of my friends. I have some friends from years and years ago from different countries in the world. And so on Sunday evenings, whenever I'm able to, and for the most part, I'm able to join for about an hour of prayer on Sunday evenings, and where everybody logs in from wherever they are and we pray together. And I've learned so much from them about prayer. It's really helped me in my own faith. It's really helped me understand the importance of prayer even more. And so we come together for prayer because it helps us in our own prayer life. Number 8, prayer helps us. Praying together helps us know each other. There's something about prayer that opens us up, right? We become quite open and vulnerable in a way in prayer. And maybe that's a scary thing for some people. And that's okay. You can start easy. You don't have to, you can come and just be part of it. But it's amazing what it does, really, because it helps us express things on our hearts, things that we feel concern for, whether in the world, whether in our families, whether with the faith of each other, something like that. And we see the heart of people when they pray. And so it helps us know each other deeper. And finally, praying together helps us know Jesus more. It helps us know Jesus more. It's one of the greatest benefits of praying together, because we are praying together in His name and we know Jesus. Tim Keller says this. He says, by praying with friends, you will be able to hear and see facets of Jesus that you have not yet perceived. By praying with friends, you will be able to hear and see facets of Jesus that you have not yet perceived. I love that. Because of the way that they relate to people and how they connect, the way they relate to Jesus and how they pray and how they talk to Him is going to help you see things about Jesus that you may not have otherwise seen. It's amazing to be able to pray together. And so I encourage you, whether in private, your private prayer life is a test of your spiritual integrity. And it's also necessary to remove your spiritual inadequacy, to help you deal with spiritual inadequacy. It helps you grow in God much more. But also praying together helps you for all of these reasons that we've listed. Praying together as a church is so vital. It's so crucial. And my prayer for you, DLCF, and for DBF Dwarka, is that we would be like that Acts church in Acts chapter 4, where we came together, we prayed together, and as we are praying together, the Spirit of God fills us, and we have the boldness and the courage to go out and live for Jesus, to be zealous for His name, and to proclaim the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ with boldness. You know, a few weeks ago, I heard a preacher say this about prayer. He says this: the pastor who does not pray is playing, and the congregation which does not pray is strain. And that's pretty convicting, isn't it? For a pastor, for the congregation, when we're not praying, we're not taking God seriously, and we're probably going to stray. And so I encourage you, my dear brothers and sisters, pray privately, in secret, and pray as a congregation together. May God bless you much as a church, even as we go through this pandemic and this lockdown and this season of quite a lot of challenge. May God give you much grace, and that somehow, even through this, whether online or some other ways, that you can meet together and pray, that you would be a praying church for your good and for the glory of God. God bless you.
With